Well, 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 well. Hello, mateys. How are you doing today? You having a wonderful day out there on DLive and Rockfin and YouTube and everywhere else that we're now live? I hope so. Hope you're having a wonderful July 4th weekend. I took the past couple of days off and celebrated a little bit early, as I will be celebrating tomorrow, but today I'm taking a chill day. So I've been doing lots of research and things like that for you guys, and I'll probably do two streams tonight. This will be the first of two, and I wanted to do this because this is the research I've been spending the most time thinking about over the past couple of days, trying to figure out in the mind if I could unlock any of these things by just sort of taking time away and thinking about things in more of a general aspect, and maybe not. I don't know. Let's get into it. So here are the show notes. They're already in all the chats for you guys. So if you're on DLive, if you're on Rockfin or YouTube, I already threw it in the chat. If you're watching the replay on BitChute, it will be in the description box. So the show notes will bring you to hive.blog at Titus Frost's latest post. And that is the show notes here. So to kick things off, as people file in, as it is a Saturday, early evening on July 4th weekend, so lots of people probably are out busy enjoying the weekend. Let's go ahead and play just a quick video to get us in, a little music, all that type of fun stuff, a little symbolism. This comes from the Sophia Music YouTube channel, which is Thomas's YouTube channel. And seemingly connected, video here to what we're talking about. And fantastic music as always. So let's take a listen and a watch. I'll actually open it up so you can see it in full screen.
Thank you.
Yes. As Da Precursor says, trippy and weird, yet at the same time, it gets the brain going, doesn't it? Now you're thinking about a whole bunch of variety of topics, and they all came from one short little video and some music. And now we're ready to divulge into the strange and the odd. In these times that we live in, these biblical times that we live in, we're seeing some of the strangest things I've ever seen in my life. You have this taking place today, a oil pipeline rupture, but the video that came out of it looked biblical. So we'll get into more of the news and things of that nature later tonight, but for now, we're doing a short stream on the cicada stuff, and then we will get back tonight on everything else. So here's another short music clip that came out. Fantastic piano work here.
Ich bin noch nicht die, die ich sein will. Bin ich ehrlich, weiß ich nicht mal wohin. Sag mir, wie soll ich dann sein, wer ich sein soll, wenn ich nicht sein darf, so wie ich bin. Ich bin noch nicht da, wo ich sein will. Bin ich ehrlich, seh ich oft keinen Sinn. Jeder zeigt mir einen Weg, den ich gehen soll, aber vielleicht gehör ich da gar nicht hin. Sag mir, mache ich mir was vor? Habe ich mich schon in all dem verloren? Ey, immer wenn es leise wird, dann frag ich mich, was stellst du dir vor, wenn du die Augen schließt? Wer würdest du sein, wenn dich sonst keiner sieht? Und was würdest du tun, wenn alles möglich ist? Wärst du dann so, wie du wirklich bist? Was würdest du sagen, wenn dich keiner hört? Wo würdest du sein, wenn keine Grenzen wären? Was würdest
get much better than that. You know, you can take your Lil Wayne and all that other types of music that's come out in the last thousand, you know, all this garbage that's come out in the last, what, 20 years? I'll take classical music over that stuff any day of the week. And with that being said, to get yourself back up, let's say you've missed some of the Cicada 331 Liber Primus 2021 journey that we've all been on. I've put it all together in a playlist for you guys right here that's in the show notes on the Ghost of Captain Frost YouTube channel. So if you want to go back and watch in sequence all of the videos that we've done so far on the subject so you don't miss anything, here they are in a playlist for you guys so you guys can go back and watch all of them, which is rather useful sometimes. Now, one of the things I've been working on today, I was just doing it for a couple of hours and trying to make sense of it all, is trying to figure out the last pages of the Liber Primus that are unsolved. So there's 17 solved pages, hashtag QAnon confirmed, just kidding. But anyways, there's 17 pages already solved, yet there is all of these pages, starting with page 0.jpg, which we'll get back to in a minute. And it goes all the way down through here. Okay, so all these pages still need to be solved. And we're trying to identify the different things on the pages. As you can see here, the tree, the last live stream, we basically established that tree came from the notes of Arsène Gaudetier, which also means it must have been a tree, maybe a famous tree, somewhere in Belgium or near where the Just Judge's painting was stolen. Maybe that tree has something to do with the location of the Just Judge's panel. Maybe there was a tree there that looked like that. I don't know, but it was in Arsène Gaudetier's notes, and I've been digging through trying to find the connections, the RSA and Godertier, the different people that are connected to him, all of this. there's so much the research and so many different things that go down, and there's so little information available on some of these people that it's very difficult to do. So, you know. Anyways, when I was doing this earlier, you know, I was translating the lines, and I put these ones out on Twitter. So if you look here, who smoked the tree? That's a good question. Who smoked the tree? Maybe it was the tree from, it's the same tree from, what's that movie? That's that show, Game of Thrones, right? Isn't there a famous tree in that? Or maybe it's the... the tree that lit the world from the books before the game, the Hobbit book. I can't remember the name of it. The Silmarillion. It's the tree from the Silmarillion that Morgoth destroyed, right? Anyways, line one. So, on this page here, these are the unsolved pages, right? So page.0.jpg, whatever. So if you take the translation that we figured out the other day, that one of the pirate solvers figured out, so you take these and you start adding them into, so these are the new things that we figured out, right, as a group. So one of our you know, guys working on this figured it out and sent it to me. So when I started going through and putting these in for where these symbols are, what I'm getting is, you know, could be something or it could be wrong. Sun and then blank, because we don't know what that next symbol is. So the big red symbol is sun, right? And then the next symbol we don't know. Then the next one, horse, don't know. Gift, man, don't know. Wealth. Sun, don't know. Horse, don't know. Don't know. And then there's the dots, like a bunch of dots, which looks like the tree of life configuration, geometric configuration to me. So maybe it's tree of life, right? Giant, none. Gift, God, I think it's a period. Wealth, none. Inherited land, possibly another period. And then line two. So that's just the first line of runes you see there. And then line two. Sun, none. Horse, none. Gift, man, none. Wealth, dot. Sun, none. Horse, none, none. Dots. So once again, there's a series of dots there. Giant, blank, we don't know what it is. Gift, God. And the God is a lowercase God. Wealth, blank, like none, we don't know what the word is. Inherited land, right? So like this is just the first two lines. And I've been doing this, going through the whole thing, writing it out. So once I get it all done, I will put it all out. And for whatever reason, I've been having a lot of trouble with Hive getting these images to load properly on Hive, because I was trying to do it on there as I went. And it wasn't loading properly. And I went back and the translation image I had put out on Hive is also not loading properly on Hive, which I don't quite understand. So I might have to go into Photoshop and edit those images to not be PNG files so that they can upload to Hive properly. Anyways, I put it out on Twitter so you can reference the link from Hive to this tweet, and there's the translation again. And with me going through and doing it for you guys. What's up there, Media Bear? Nice to have you there in the chat. Is this Anglo-Saxon runic alphabet? No, this is, as we talked about, this is, well, the ones that we're using here are Elder Futhark runes, which are also these other ones, Elder English, Elder Futhark runes, right? So that's what they wrote it in, but it's not just one language. We know that from earlier in the thing. We figured out that this is written in three languages, right? This Liber Primus thing. Hold on. There it is. So this is wait, three different languages, all phonetic. And when we're applying the one, that's what we have so far. Obviously, it's a triple layer encryption. And I think also if we were to take some, like, it's definitely got a musical element to it. So I wonder if we were to apply. How did they write music back in like the 1400s, the Knights Templar and all that? Has it always been the same with lines of music, or was it different back in the day? I wonder if you wrote this out as like a musical line of code with numbers associated for the different letters, if it wouldn't make more sense as like a line of music that was then encrypted as words and language. Right? Because that's kind of what I feel like we're looking at here is some sort of musical score. And granted, the connections of the guys who made the puzzle, right? They obviously have a huge love of music and they're composers, musical composers, some of the best musical composers probably alive today. So, with that being said, like, obviously, they encoded this, in my opinion. That way, a musical encryption. And music is also math. That's why I think possibly if you go back, we also assign numbers to some of these letters as well. Now, interestingly, another thing that I thought was kind of interesting when some of the other solvers back in the day, and it's always good to go back and see what other people have tried. These other guys, the other older group that tried to do this that I'm not a part of, these guys went over and met one of these NSA
Hey.
guys, these like NSA historian guys who knows about like all these different types of encryption and things. So interestingly, this guy had a kind of an interesting idea, and now that we know like at least we think we know the words for some of this. It maybe if we apply this Friedman tactic, we might be able to get the rest of the words.
How's it going?
So
One
just
cool is
take a
connecting
listen
with
to
Craig
this real
Bauer,
quick.
one of the world.
So I was trying to explain to like the wife, like, you know, what the hell this is all about. And I was like, this is a short documentary about like the other guys that tried to do this years ago that failed because they didn't realize it was in three different languages.
Top crypto experts in hopes of gaining some insight in order to crack the Liber Primus.
And they also didn't realize that this thing had a musical component to it. So both of those reasons, like they weren't looking at it correctly, and it also it ties in with the Ghent altarpiece, not just Da Vinci paintings. Like the Da Vinci painting connection was obvious, but the Ghent altarpiece connection has been much more difficult to realize.
Bauer's a former resident historian in the NSA and is literally.
Frequency is the key. And it's interesting you say that, Snapkill, because I feel like that is, there's got to be some sort of frequency to this here that has like a tie to music that would help us break this thing, right? Anyways, let's get back to this right here.
literally written the book on famous unsolved puzzles.
Gematria Primus. This was what they revealed in one of the puzzles, and that was used directly to decode some pages. So it's the mapping from rune to English letter. Very last page of this, it translates directly here to P. The next one was A. So this says parable.
So was the last page the only one that was a substitution cipher?
That's a great question. The second to last page was encrypted with the.
Yes, 432 hertz is like an older. Maybe we should talk about that in a second. Remind me of that at the end of the show.
Stream of numbers. So that gave us the message that said we had to seek out a page on the deep web. They said it's everybody's duty to find this page.
I mean, we know that Cicada's obsessed with prime numbers, forgetting about, you know, this rune correspondence. It sounds like they have really modern implementations like steganography and things you have to look for through outguess.
Yeah.
It's not just flat out math, 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 right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, and this guy just nailed it. It's not just math, math, math. And a lot of these, like, other solvers, that's, like, what they were doing. They were looking at straight math and stuff like that. There's got to be more to this than that. Like, this, you're not going to just crack this with just one thing. It's going to be multiple. It's a three-dimensional thing. So there's something from history that's going to help us, something from the frequency, if we can determine the frequency, and then the actual letters themselves.
Maybe the key is text, in which case Friedman's attack and its generalizations would be a good approach.
William Friedman was a genetic...
Now, this attack I thought might be kind of interesting since we know some of the words we think already. Like, if we were to apply this attack to it, knowing some of the translated letters already that we already have from the unsolved pages, maybe this might give us some more of the... or at least a breakdown of what the missing words might be.
Geneticist who took on cryptography as a hobby. He later became the first chief cryptologist at the NSA. Friedman invented a technique of putting two texts side by side and counting the number of times that identical letters appear in the same position in both texts. Friedman's attack looked at the frequency certain letters appear and was thereby able to determine whether it was a simple or a complex encoded message. While this may not sound like much, it greatly reduces the nearly infinite possibilities you have to try on a puzzle like the Liber Primus.
So Friedman's attack would basically look at the pairings most likely to give you the letter you see.
So those very infrequent letters, then you can kind of discard and focus on the common English letters, right?
Yes, you might be missing a few letters where rarer letters came into play, but it would just be like reading a book with a lot of typos.
Really? Wow, that's fascinating, because it's kind of like taking the analysis we've done and really taking it a step further, because I've never heard of that, and those are kind of...
Yeah, I hadn't heard of it either, so kind of interesting to me. And since I was, like, going through and trying to basically, you know, fill in the blanks here, you know, like, basically, this is what I've gotten to so far on these unsolved pages. So I was thinking maybe if I applied that Friedman attack with these already here, and just looked at how many times, because it seems to me that a lot of these words keep appearing over and over again in this text. So I wonder if we did that with this and applied it, if we would get a frequency for each word. Wouldn't that be kind of interesting? Anyways, people are always asking, like, you know, what are these primes? What are these prime numbers? Here's the prime numbers, okay? So, like, obviously, a big part of this puzzle is prime numbers. I just kind of put this in here for reference for people that didn't know what those were. That are trying to help with this, you know? Because a whole bunch of, like, average people helping may actually solve this thing. You never know who's going to come up with the answer for this. A prime number is a whole number that is only divisible by the one and self. For example, 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13, 17, 19, and 23, all examples of primes. Dividing them by anything other than themselves or the number 1 results in a fraction. Prime numbers are often used in cryptography and as a method for generating some kinds of random numbers. For example, in RSA encryption, two large arbitrary prime numbers are multiplied to generate a semi-prime, from which a public encryption key is generated. For a recipient to decrypt the message without the private key, they would need to determine the two prime numbers used to create the semi-prime. With the large prime numbers, it is extremely complex and time-intensive to determine those two numbers. Therefore, the private key is required to decrypt the message. Okay? And I thought there was this interesting tweak because most people don't think of this. And TS was like, if I say those seeking a forest of primes overlook a single tree named Zero, a non-prime, a non-composite, zero n equals zero, zero over n equals zero, you respond, oh. So, interestingly, what is a prime number? Not included in this is the number zero, as you can notice. But zero, a non-prime, a non-composite, right? Because you can't divide by zero. A single tree named zero. I wonder if that has to do with the tree that we're looking for. That was the cracking the code thing I just showed you guys. And then another interesting thing here was on the Ghent altarpiece. Snapkill noticed this. Three sets of three. Alignments? Possibly. You see the three sets of three constellations? Except for... this one's very hard to see, but if you look like really close, you can see it. See this one right here? So you got 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3 for 9. Interesting. I wonder what those constellations are, if they map out to anything. Interestingly, I was reading up on the stealing of the Mystic Lamb, which is, you know, what we're looking for is the missing panel. Supposedly, the panel of the Just Judges has a location of the Arma de Christi, which is the instruments that were used to crucify Jesus Christ. So, reading about the guy who stole this part of the painting, one of the most famous paintings in the entire world that's still missing today. Gaudiotier's resume further suggests that stealing from a Catholic institution would have been his least likely course of action. Even in desperation, as the president of several Catholic charitable societies and as recipient of public honors for years of participation, Gaudiotier was a model citizen and model Catholic. A skeptic might say that his elevated status would give him unusual access to and connections within the Catholic Church of Belgium. Did he use his status as the perfect cover? Oh, no. Please, no. I just read this earlier. Okay, there we go. To infiltrate and steal from the cathedral. Then there was a separate problem of logistics. If Gaudiotier was the thief, the size and weight of the panels meant that Gaudiotier could not have acted alone. The following year, on May 9th, 1935, Crown Prosecutor Dehaene placed a placard on a wall in Ghent requesting information that might lead to discovery of the panel, offering a reward of 25,000 Belgian francs, about 7,500 today. The public appeal, months after the fact, was considered by contemporaries to be insufficient and belated. So it seems that the authorities were also involved in the cover-up of what all of this. They didn't even try to get the painting back at the time. To make matters odder, it was only at the end of April 1935 that the police and the magistrates informed the Diocese of Ghent about Gaudiotier's deathbed confession 5 months after it had occurred. The diocese welcomed this news, finally someone whom they could blame, albeit a deceased peer of the secular arm of the Catholic politics and one who seemed to be something of a deus ex machina. But why would neither had secretive magistrates nor the influential police inform the diocese sooner? One can only assume that members of the diocese were suspected of involvement in the crime. but ultimately dismissed as innocent, whether or not they truly were. 6 days later, when word of Godertier and the ransom notes had leaked to the press, Dr. de Kock was asked about his late friend by a journalist for the Flemish daily newspaper, De Standard. He said, Godertier was a very eccentric man. Arsène Godertier was no ordinary man. He had his own very particular way of doing and thinking that was very peculiar. He certainly never seemed insane to me, but he would never have been accused of being a normal person. He dove into everything, doted on the most trivial matters, to the point where his friends, sometimes had to separate ourselves from him because he would go on ad nauseum if something interested him, explaining endlessly. An enigmatic way to describe one's deceased friend, suggesting that those close to the Godertier were at a loss. So to me, from what this reads here, it seems like the police also thought that he had help from within the Catholic Church of Belgium, and that one of these other people that he worked with helped him hide this thing away. That makes me think that this panel, the missing panel, is in this diocese in one of these churches of Belgium. Which church, I don't know, but it would seem to me that maybe it's hidden away in one of these churches. Because that would make a lot of sense. Maybe it's not in St. Bavo, because they knew they would rip up St. Bavo looking for it. Maybe they moved it from St. Bavo to a nearby church and stashed it away there, knowing that it would be easier to hide somewhere nearby. I thought this was interesting. So we've taken a real good close look at the Ghent altarpiece itself, but on this closer to Van Eyck thing, there's also this further works by Van Eyck. And interestingly, the brother Hubert Van Eyck didn't paint any of these, but Jan Van Eyck did paint a whole bunch of other paintings, and they're on display all around the world. And that makes me wonder if some of these don't have clues as well, or possibly are near the Just Judges. Like, maybe they moved the Just Judges to be in the same place as one of these other paintings, or maybe there's a clue to where it is in one of the other paintings. Or maybe there's other things that we can find in these. But I just thought it was interesting, and I also wanted to map out where all these things were. So that was one of the other things I was looking at. You can see a lot of these paintings are still over there. You have Bruges, Antwerp, Rotterdam. You have some of the more famous ones in London, Paris, Madrid, all over the place. Turin. It's an interesting one down in Turin. This is St. Francis. See the very interesting depiction of Jesus Christ in this. That's generally not how they depict Jesus on the cross, is it not? I mean, that's very strange. He's like flying with like parrot wings. Right? I mean, that's got to be one of the most strange depictions of Jesus I've ever seen. Dresden has a lot of these, including two of these, like, statuesque type panels. I thought this was interesting. You have diptych with Saint John the Baptist here and the Virgin. You know, everything's connected to Saint John at the Saint Bavo Cathedral. And this is in Paris, I believe at the Louvre, right? And there's Saint John the Baptist with the Virgin. He's holding the lamb. So it's interesting. So they mapped out all of his paintings here, which I thought was kind of interesting. The seraphim, which are heavenly beings. Yeah, it's kind of a depiction of the seraphim, exactly. Another thing I was thinking, I was like, maybe if we looked at like where the Nazis were looking for this, that would help us check off or at least know like some of the places that they looked for it. And I was trying to find more information on that. This article here was like one of the better ones on the Nazis looking for this thing. It's called Why Hitler and Hermann Göring Went to War Over the Ghent Altarpiece. The lesser-known Hubert van Eyck didn't leave the sea of his completed magnificence of the Adoration of the Mystic Lamb, which consisted of 12 panels depicting of religious scenes and saints. It was one of the most intricate oil paintings ever to be produced, and the result was powerful and stunning works of religious art. A game of musical looting ensued. Hitler got his hands on the work first, when the Nazi unit assigned to plundering cultural treasures grabbed it from the castle south of France where the Belgians had attempted to hide it. Not willing to concede the prize, Göring had one of his aides seize the 12-panel piece. But Hitler found him out and ordered his men to step in and take it once more. The Ghent altarpiece was stored along many of its world's greatest treasures in one of the infamous salt mines where it was discovered by the monuments men at the end of the war. Safe to say the Ghent altarpiece has been through its share of trauma, not to mention it has been witness some major historical events. The only damage to the Ghent altarpiece continues to this day occurred in 1934, several years before the madness of World War II engulfed the region, when thieves hid in St. Bavo Cathedral before closing one April night. After the door has been locked, the thieves broke into the chapel where the painting hung and ripped the lower left panel, the Just Judges, from the rest of the altarpiece. They escaped without a trace. They monitored border crossings and stuff like that and ports. That's why I think it's still in Belgium somewhere. It's probably in another cathedral in Belgium, so they didn't have to cross a border or have to go out of a port with it, so it could stay nearby but be completely hidden away. And the Church of Belgium, like the Catholics that would have helped Arsene do this, would have had access to all these other churches in the area. Then, blah, blah, blah. So there, and there's like, so you can see like Hitler and Göring were fighting over this thing. And that's about it. That's like all you can really find about the Nazis looking for this on like a couple little articles. So there's really not much. So it's really, really hard to figure out where were they looking for it. Did they look for the other panel, and where did they look? Did they go like tearing through Europe looking for this in other places and not find it? Which places did they check out? You know, all that'd be kind of interesting to know. Here you have this. It's called Revelation Becomes Stone. It's about the St. Bavo Cathedral. The Revelation Becomes Stone in the Cathedral of St. Bavo. A few years ago, more than a century after laying of the first stone, the Sagrada Familia Church in Barcelona was consecrated. It's probably the most famous example of sacred modern architecture in Europe, but is not the only church to have been built at this end of the 19th century. Many other churches and some cathedrals were built in that century, a period that is incorrectly considered lacking religious feeling as a result of the Enlightenment. One of these buildings is the Cathedral of St. Bavo in Haarlem in the Netherlands. This paper reviews the most important construction phases and describes the symbolism of the building, which is inspired by the final chapters of the Book of Revelation. Just like the altarpiece itself is inspired by the Revelations. Like, it's the story of baptism and the move from the old to the new revelation. Architect Joseph Cuppers was 32 years old when he took on the most important assignment of his life, designed the new cathedral of Haarlem Amsterdam Diocese. He was the son of the most famous architects in the Netherlands. His father, Pierre, designed the imposing train station of Amsterdam. So, it talks a little bit about the different parts of the church and all that stuff. So, it's an interesting read if you guys want to go through it. The big conic dome, copper-coated, about 60 meters high, is visible from kilometers away, seen from the nave. The dome reveals itself as a book transformed into architecture, not just a simple book at that, but the last book of the New Testament Revelations. Each symbol is sculpted in the material that the dome is made of. Originally in the pavement of the nave corresponding the dome, the zodiac symbols were represented. This place is in fact a little piece of sky because it is near the altar, the place where the heavenly Jerusalem comes down from the sky seen above. So the zodiac was put in the floor. God the Father, from his throne, looks at the sky represented by the zodiac coming down on the earth, which is his place where his project of salvation has already begun, and the sacrifice of his son renewed in the Eucharist, celebrated on the altar. Everything in St. Botho Cathedral has a specific symbolic meaning, which makes it very element, following the example of other majestic cathedrals, a catechism for the faithful. Also found this to be an interesting article here in Ghent. So you can see there's the weird painting we were just looking at there with the seraphim looking Jesus. Partial to the Flemish primitives and indeed to the Flemish in general. So up here the current exhibition in Ghent, Van Eyck, an optical revolution, offering the largest Van Eyck exhibition ever, containing 10 of his 20 odd works known to survive, was not to be missed. So we set off to Ghent. John of Gaunt was born in St. Bavo's Abbey. Scurrilous rumor is a local butcher rather than Edward I, Eurostar to Brussels, blah, blah, blah. The long-term project of conservation of the altarpiece, usually explained in small display outside the chapel in St. Bavo's Cathedral, in which it is currently kept, the building of a new visitor center due to open October has led to the discovery of a large ossuary against the cathedral wall. Remember that was the bone structure, the structure made out of human bones? With not only startling new old brightness and clarity in the colors, but some remarkable changes of feeling or emphasis. Of the most notable is the expression on the face of the lamb. A former passive resignation has been replaced by a challenging gaze at the viewer. You see the different paintings. They're talking about it compares other things. Another fascinating opportunity was to compare the two versions of St. Francis receiving the stigmata from the Philadelphia Museum of Art and the Galleria Sabauda in Turin, respectively. For the very little that is worth, I prefer the Philadelphia version for the handling of the light. Both confirm my view. Previously based on reproductions, the position of the saint's legs is very unconvincing. Also, in that both versions were probably once owned by the Adorns family of Bruges. So, Who are these people? In Bruges. The Adorns family of Bruges. Might be another rabbit hole we can go down one day. Here's the different places that you can find these like paintings and stuff out there. So kind of a little interesting write-up by a professor about in Ghent. Now, some of the other older solvers, you know, they don't necessarily deserve to be talked about in this this video because we're doing actual research into really important topics, but you know, with that being said, obviously this is important enough to show you guys because people looking into Cicada stuff probably recognize the name DeFango because he's one of the people that tried to solve it unsuccessfully in the past. And then attacked the Cicada thing for no good reason. Anyways, to set the record straight, I was here telling the truth when I had 12 followers. I was allowing people to speak, tell their stories, and make their claims when I had 1,200 followers. The purpose of the platform will not be pushed off track based on numbers. Who wants it? Says Stu Peters. And Cowboy JMS, whoever that is, responds, look into this. And you look into it, I guess there's some sort of new lawsuit taking place. Free Speech Systems, LLC. DBA, InfoWars, and Agents Thereof, June 29th, 2021. And this is from the law office of Kelly Sorrell out of Granbury, Texas. So I guess they're going after Scott Adams, Haley Kennington, Ali Akbar, Roger Stone, Rob Dew, Alex Jones, you know, the InfoWar crew. And InfoWars, it seems to me, is connected to even more people than you'd imagine. At least according to this lawsuit, they are. And the only reason I bring this up in this video is because one of the people in here is Emmanuel DeFango Chavez, is named in this. My office has retained to pursue damages against Free Speech Systems, LLC, doing business as InfoWars, for the actions of Alex Jones, Rob Dew, Caitlin Bennett, Liberty Hangout, Ali Abdul Razak Akbar, Ali Alexander, Roger Stone, Emmanuel DeFango Chavez, Haley Kennington, Miranda Heisler, Scott Adams, Red State Radio, Angela Kimball, and Owen Schroyer, each individually and in concert under the banner of InfoWars, to exploit the gross sexual crimes against a minor under the age of 14 years old for profit. The above referenced individuals conspired or acted in concert using electronic means, video, audio, email, direct messaging on social media posts, text messages, and image board posts linked to specific IP addresses to exploit minor Jane Doe. After an exhaustive investigation, third-party investigators have uncovered evidence of the conspiracy which resulted in the exploitation of the minor child. And I have also advised my client to file a criminal complaint with law enforcement, period. So this is part of a civil lawsuit. These are the claims of this law firm here, and I'm just reporting on those claims. I don't know if these are accurate or not. I'm not involved in this case, but I found it interesting, and it does relate to the Cicada thing as DeFango, Emmanuel Chavez, LARPing as pirate citizen, even though he's not a pirate and doesn't know how to sail, is being sued as part of this, and he's being listed as a member of InfoWars. So it seems that Maybe the InfoWars group is larger than it displays itself as. So, anyways, I've had problems with every person listed on this thing here. So that's also interesting. And I've had problems with every person associated with InfoWars. Every last one of them. And then you have another person that was associated with the Cicada stuff back in the day and has been disassociated from it, from what I know, because of his actions. And he also has stated that he is a, you know, into underage girls because of what he did. And you can see he's still using music made by Thomas to share videos and stuff. So here's Lestat DeFoya, and he's, you know, let's hear it, right? This music for this video belongs to Thomas. So once again, don't steal things that do not belong to you. Don't go around posting stuff as if it's your own when you didn't even make the music for it. When I go around posting other people's stuff, I always give them credit. I always put a link to the original stuff in the show notes because that's what people deserve. You don't deserve to go and steal people's copyright and not ever give them credit, especially when you have gone around and defamed them and attacked them relentlessly and made like ridiculously long videos and burned an entire 60,000 subscriber YouTube channel because you wanted to attack someone. Like, the actions of Lestat and DeFango are both absolutely pathetic. And that's why they're not working on solving puzzles, they're working on being pathetic. So with that being said, that's the end of this stream. I'll be back later tonight. We'll do another live stream on news type stuff. Probably, you know, maybe like 9:30, 10-ish. We'll just come on and have like a fun live stream for like an hour or so about the recent happenings in the news and the stuff you guys dropped in the DLive chat. But I wanted to do a standalone video on the Cicada stuff because it's been on the top of my mind, really. And I found it, you know, fascinating. And I thought you guys might want to see the stuff I was looking at. And see if you guys have any more things to chime in on or any other leads that you guys come up with. So thank you all for watching. I really do appreciate it. This has been your captain speaking. And I will see you guys back here later tonight for a news stream. And then we'll do another Cicada stream on our new findings. Probably in the next couple of days as we find more stuff. And I'll keep digging and translating and all of that fun stuff. So make sure to go to hive.blog at Titus Frost and follow me on there so you guys can keep up with the show notes and get paid for watching and liking the content I put out. All right. Peace out there, everyone. I'll see you later. Take care.